Hello, sports fans, and welcome to the Press Box. This will be our last show for the fall season. I'm your host, Jeff Richardson. I'm going to be joined tonight by Ty Reynolds. We're all alone tonight, Ty and I. I guess we'll try to make a go of it and see what we can do here.
Hey, it had to be the weather.
I think everybody cut out of town on us or something. Ty, before we get started, our phone number is 873-6713. Audience, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to call us. Let's start with this College Bowl coalition. Talk about how effective it was. We've got a national championship game.
Well, I think basically what they wanted to accomplish was a national championship type game, and that's what they got. It worked out for them this year. But don't buy it, Jeff. They were out for number one. What they did was great for the public, but they were out for number one and for themselves and money. And that really showed in the matchup with the Cotton Bowl.
Yeah, I was about to, I wanted to bring that up. The Cotton Bowl made sort of a questionable decision by picking Notre Dame over Florida State. Evidently, money or TV ratings came into play, and they sort of skipped over the coalition. Good or bad?
Well, the Cotton Bowl, if for some reason Miami and Alabama end up in a tie, they ended up making a terrible decision, but they won't know until after their game is over with.
All right, I think we have a phone call. Caller, you're on the air.
Yeah, I'm wondering what you think is going to happen to Jerry Glanville this year. I mean, obviously they're not having a very good season. I'm wondering if you think that they're going to get rid of him by next year.
All right, I know what I'd like to see happen to him. By the way, thanks for your call and keep watching. I hope he gets gone. I'm ready for him to leave, Ty.
Well, I don't like the philosophy he has on defense, but I think he's going to stay. The seats have been sold out, and the Rankin Smith family, as usual, looks at the bottom line before winning. And the seats have been sold out, so I think Jerry Glanville will stay.
Well, they had a lot of empty seats in there last week, though, Ty.
Well, that's maybe true. But they were sold. That's okay. The key thing.
All right, so we both want Jerry to go. I guess that's the answer to your question. Ty, let's get back to the College Bowl games. Let's get back to Miami and Alabama, basically, national title game.
Right, this is going to be a really good football game. And Alabama, well, let's go back and look at their matchup against Florida. Florida really matched up well with them. They had an offense that they ran that basically took advantage of any weakness that Alabama had. If Alabama has a weakness, it's their over-aggressiveness defensively, and Florida used it to get quick pass plays out to their wide receivers. I don't think Gino Toretta is nearly as good as Shane Matthews in running that type of an offense. And that's why I think Alabama's going to match up much better having their defense play against Miami's offense.
All right, well, let's talk about the other side of the ball, Alabama's offense against Miami's defense.
Well, Alabama, first of all, the first thing that came to my mind is which team has the better running game. And I think Alabama does have the better running game. I think they have really a solid offensive line. I think they have about the most underrated offensive line in the country. So I think they're going to have a little advantage there with the running game. In the passing game, Barker goes out and does what he needs to do. He'll complete the little third and seven, third and eight once in a while. But what Alabama has got to do is to keep Miami from getting big plays and cheap scores. They did it against Penn State and beat them with the interception by a defensive lineman. But the main thing that Alabama has to worry about is not let people like Kevin Williams and Thomas get out there and get one-on-one coverage and beat their men for long touchdown passes.
I think I'm about to disagree with you on the Alabama strengths as far as running, or as far as Jay Barker getting the job done. Florida made sure they made Alabama throw the ball, and that's what kept them in the ball game. They're not a very good passing team. Well, I think we have another phone call. Let's go to the callers. You're on the air.
Hi. I got a question about Garrison Hurst.
All right.
Do you think he's going to turn pro if he doesn't win the Heisman?
Good question, and thanks for your call. I personally think he's going to turn pro whether he wins it or not, and I'm going to base my theory on the article that appeared in the paper the other day. Ty, what do you think?
Jeff, I don't think there's any doubt about it. I think he's going to turn pro regardless of what happens. When you look at this city, there was really a bad move that was made by a player at Georgia Tech, and that was Ken Swilling. Mm-hmm. After his junior year, his stock was as high as it was ever going to get. He was a first-round pick, I think, no less than a second-round pick. And he just lost everything his senior year, and cost him a lot of money.
Yeah, I think money's the bottom line. There's really no reason for Garrison to stay when you can, you know, he could get injured and lose millions of dollars. I think we do have another phone call. Caller, you're on the air. Hello?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
I was just wondering if you could assess Eric Zier's performance this year.
All right. Personally, I was a little bit disappointed in his performance this year. I thought he had a better year last year.
I think it was up and down. The main concern I have were his interceptions. He threw way too many interceptions. As a freshman, he only threw four. And he was in double digits in interceptions this year. Mm-hmm. I thought he threw into double coverage a lot, especially when teams are playing a two-deep zone, guarding against the wide receivers. And he did not use his fullback and his tight end enough this year. And he threw four passes to Shannon Mitchell, the tight end, against Georgia Tech. And I tell you, Jeff, he could have thrown a lot more to him.
He's been doing that all year. I think some of the blame can go maybe to Wayne McDuffie and the coaches for playing the offensive line. The starting five offensive linemen played way too much. He got tired and worn down and injured at the end of the year. And I think that contributed to Eric's performance a little bit.
Regardless, though, I think there's a lot of teams out there that wouldn't mind getting those types of numbers from their quarterback, though.
Oh, yeah. I think we could trade him to just about anybody. All right, let's go on to another bowl game, Georgia and Ohio State.
Well, Jeff, first of all, I want to go back for a second back to Alabama.
All right.
And Miami. First of all, this team did score 21 points against a pretty good Florida defense, although it is a rebuilding year for them. And like I said, Barker is no Tourette or anything like that. He is a guy that can get the job done. What he has to do is not make mistakes. And I'll just leave it at that. I think Miami's going to win, but I get the feeling the game's going to be something like a 7-point spread, maybe 8. I don't think they could cover that,
Miami finds a way to win these big ball games every year. I'd hate to pick against them. I think I'm going to agree with you and pick Miami.
Yep.
All right, let's go on down to the Citrus Bowl, Georgia and Ohio State.
This is a game, Jeff, to me, that Georgia should control. I think they have a lot more speed than Ohio State. What they have to do defensively is just make sure Robert Smith doesn't run those counter plays like he did against Michigan in the first quarter and keep him bottled up. And they may make Herb Street come out and throw against him and see what happens. I think Georgia played pretty well against the run this year. But against the pass, they were not a good football team. Georgia was a bad defensive team with third and long and fourth and long, and it really cost them this year.
Well, I think you need to qualify that by saying anybody with a semi-sophisticated passing attack was able to move the ball on us pretty easily.
Oh, Jeff, Ole Miss completed a third and 15 play against them. So I don't know about that.
All right, our phone number is 873-6713. Feel free to call us with any questions, and we'll keep talking about the Dogs for a minute. Do you think they got a break by drawing Ohio State instead of NC State?
Well, first of all, I think your team is really going to get up to play Ohio State. They're a team with a lot of tradition and a big name. Here it is, if you play North Carolina State, well, who really wants to play them coming out of a league like the Southeastern Conference with a record like Georgia's? Georgia has a lot more tradition. They have a much bigger name, and they don't have anything to gain but a lot to lose. Here in this game with Ohio State, it's even. I mean, both teams have something to gain and something to lose.
Well, this gives the Big Ten a chance to, they like to brag and say they play the best football around. This gives them a chance to prove it, and I say bring it on. I don't think they're going to be able to beat Georgia.
No, Georgia would have to lose to Ohio State, to be honest with you. If they made a bunch of mistakes offensively, turnovers, if Zaire just for some reason ended up throwing in a double coverage too many times and got picked off, which lost field position and gave Ohio State some easy scores, Ohio State could win this football game. But if they play their offense like they did against Georgia Tech, and they ran that offense well, mm-hmm. they should win that game and should control just have control of the line of scrimmage.
All right, let's go back to the phones. Caller, you're on the air.
Yes, I think everyone's over. I don't think Ohio State's as good as their hype. I don't think the Big Ten overall is as good as their hype. And it's been, you know, every time they go into a big bowl game, they get beat by teams that are much more athletic. But I will say that in the future, I think they got a game named Nathan Walker coming in next year. And I think he's got a good chance of turning it around there. But Cooper, there's just too much attention on other stuff but football there.
I agree with you. I think the Big Ten is overrated. You know, back in the 50s and 60s, they may have been playing the best football around, but certainly not nowadays. Thanks for the call, and keep watching.
Yeah, I'll agree with you. I think something that the Big Ten lacks a lot of speed, and something else that really affects the Big Ten is the rule with junior college players. Larry Kennedy came out of Sarasota, Florida as a Prop 48 player. He signed with Ohio State, but he never did qualify. Now, under the rules, if he had gone to a junior college, he would have had to stay there 2 years and then go to a Big Ten school, sit out 1 year, and he can only play 1 year. If you have 1 year at a big-time school, that's really not going to give you much of a chance to accomplish anything. And I really think that hurts the Big Ten.
That's why we saw Kennedy transfer to Florida instead of Ohio State.
Right. I think he transferred to Florida and stayed out the 1 year as a Prop 48.
Yeah. All right, we got another call. Caller, you're on the air.
Yes, if Marge Schott and Jan Kemp were on the dating game, who would you choose?
No, good grief.
I think I might take Shotzi in that case.
Good
thanks for the
grief.
Call. All right,
Jan Kemp, what a nightmare.
Oh, boy, let's don't bring her up. This is 1992, so. All right, let's go out to the Peach Bowl. That's a local game of interest. We got Mississippi State and sort of drawing a blank. Is it North Carolina?
It's North Carolina. North Carolina's been an up-and-coming team over there. Mack Brown has really done a good job in recruiting the players from that state. It'll really be interesting in that state to see what he gets this year because there's heavy rumors now that Dick Sheridan is going to be leaving there to go to Auburn. And we can talk about that in a minute, Jeff.
Okay.
As for Mississippi State, they don't have a quarterback, and they need one badly.
Well, I think they've got two or three young kids, but they
don't
have any established.
No one established to get the job done, and they should have beaten Ole Miss. They had so many chances inside the 10-yard line and did not get the ball in the end zone. So that could cost them in this football game.
All right. Well, the calls are heating up the lines here. Caller, you're on the air.
Hi.
Hi, go ahead.
I need to know if are you familiar with the defensive back from Florida, the second-string defensive back?
Well, I'm talking
Tony Vaughn.
Tony Vaughn. No.
I know they have Oliver, Will White.
Okay. Well, the reason one of my questions was I don't know who else to ask about this. If he's going to go pro, but you're not familiar with him?
He's second string defensive back, and he's going to go pro.
That's from what I understood.
Okay. That's not to insult your intelligence or anything, but I think that's a little far fetched though for
right.
a second string guy.
Right. If you're a second-string player in the college game, no matter what school you're at, I really think that you got a little work to do. Maybe joining the team as a free agent and showing something there to the coaches, but that's a long way.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thanks for the call, and keep watching. Ty, let's see, we've talked about the Peach Bowl. We've talked about the Citrus Bowl. How about the Gator Bowl? You got Florida against, is it Syracuse there?
No, it's North Carolina State.
Okay.
And that's a game that I really hope Florida goes down there and wants to play. Florida's a lot of times the type of team that packs it in after a big loss or two and just quits. And they seem to have that reputation. And this is a good young football team. And I hope they don't have that attitude because this is a rebuilding year for them. They have two freshmen on their offensive line. They have two young players on their defensive line, Johnny Church and Kevin Carter. And this is a team that is really going to be a strong team in the Southeastern Conference and for the powers to have to deal with, like Georgia and Alabama over there. I think they're going to use this as a stepping stone into next year.
As much as I hate to say it, I think you're right. Florida's an up-and-coming team, and they're already pretty damn good. So.
They are.
All right, let's switch the subject to the Braves. They signed Greg Maddox this week. Good move or bad?
Oh, it's a great move, and I tell you what else makes it a great move is the way they've managed their money. Here it is, Charlie Liebrand was earning somewhere like around $3 million a year. They go ahead, move him out, and bring Maddox in, who has his contract, $28 million for 5 years. True, you're paying a little bit more, but you're getting another great, strong young arm in there. Charlie won 15 games last year, and I don't know if he can match that again this year.
Well, he won 15 the year before also.
True, and people are really looking at this pitching staff as being the best staff in baseball, and they're right. But let's not overlook the fact that how many more wins can Maddox get over what Charlie did last year? I mean, if he gets 20 wins, that's only five better than Liebrand.
Personally, I think the Braves could have spent their money better. If we had a decent bullpen, we would have been world champs the last 2 years. I say you go out and sign a closer or trade for one instead of another starting pitcher.
Jeff, that's definitely the right move to make, and I'll tell you why. The Braves' number five starter is Pete Smith, who could win 15 games. Mm-hmm. Now, the Reds and the Astros don't even know who their fifth starter is. I think they would be happy to get 10 wins from that position, but let's just say they get eight. Well, now, right now, if Smith stays healthy, I think he can win 15. That's seven games you're behind right there. Where are you going to make the games up? Are you going to make them up against the Braves' four starters? I don't think so. So you got to make them up with the bullpen and with home runs. And like I said, the bullpen is where the Braves need some help. And they lost El Pena. You saw where he signed with Pittsburgh.
Signed with Pittsburgh.
And they need, if anyone is successful saving games back there, they need them to stay healthy.
All right, we're going to take a break and go to our resident sports card collecting expert, Rick Rapa from Gwinnett Sports Cards.
Thank you, Jeff and Ty. It's time for the holiday edition of the Collector's Corner. This is the time of the year where most card shops are the most busy. December, the month of the holidays, people are buying gifts for their friends and their relatives. Plus, it's the end of 1 year of collecting and the beginning of a second year. There's a few surprises right now in the collecting world, one being that we're in the middle of football season right now. Yet, as far as card collecting goes, football is kind of dead. There's a few reasons for this. One is because there's really no hot rookie player this year. The two glamour boys of college last year, one Steve Entman, the first-round draft pick for the Colts, he went out injured early this year, and the other, Desmond Howard, just hasn't fit in with much of the plans with the Redskins. So football has not been that collectible. That and because there's so many card companies making football, it's hard to decide which company is the one to go with. There's over 25 football companies, and you don't know which one's going to go up, which one's going to go down, which one to speculate in. So it's surprising that football has not been collected very well this year. The other surprising thing is how quickly out of the blocks hockey and basketball have come this year. Basketball is extremely hot, mostly because of the current crop of rookie players. Everyone knows Shaquille O'Neal, Christian Laettner, Alonzo Mourning. Also, guys like Adam Keefe on the Hawks is doing all right. Robert Horry for Houston, Walt Williams for Sacramento. There's quite a few guys who are collected. And the company that seems to have capitalized most on this is called Classic Games. They've got exclusive contracts with college players, and so they try to get these guys first right out of college. Now, they make cards in this box here called the Classic 4-in-1 Draft Picks. This has all four sports, basketball, hockey, baseball, and football. And you can get Shaquille O'Neal, like I said, Laettner. O'Neal is only in Classic Games. He will not be in the other companies until after January 1st. So his card's been trading between $8 and $10. Laettner sells for $3 or $4 and has been very hot. And Mourning is also about $3 or $4. Also with these classic cards, you get hockey. And the hottest card in there right now has been Manon Raymond, the girl goaltender for the Knights. She has cards only in Classic also. And every time we get a card in, it seems like it sells almost instantaneously. They sell for $5 or $10. And people trade them in, and the first person who sees them when they come in the store normally buys them. The classic cards, I don't know if you can see them on the camera, but they look sort of like this. They're kind of small, but they get the college players in their college uniforms. Here's Desmond Howard, who only has a card with Classic, and this is also a Desmond Howard card. They're kind of small, so I don't know if you can actually see them, but these college players are only in the Classic Games, and they're the hottest players. Also at this time of the year, in the same vein with Classic, Upper Deck is putting out a minor league set, which is called Upper Deck Miners. And what they do is take the 10 top prospects from every team in the majors, you know, the Braves, the Red Sox, et cetera. Some of the players are a little obscure right now because they've just been drafted. The Brave players, of course, are famous in this area, Chipper Jones, Mike Kelly, Melvin Nieves. And you might get fellows on other teams you haven't heard of, but hopefully in 2 or 3 years, they'll be on the major league teams and you'll have their first card because being out there in the minors, Topps, Donruss, and Fleer, the regular companies, aren't making these cards yet. Also out this year, early, is Donruss 93. That is the major league card, and they're the first company this year to put out a card. They're kind of ahead of the game, since it is only December, but they like to get them out before the Christmas shopping season ends, and I think I have a box of those right here. There's big white box. They come out. They're about $35 per box retail, $26 if you can find them wholesale somewhere. And we've got a few of the cards. They look nicer this year than in the past. They're big and glossy and clear on the front. There's not that much cluttering the picture. Once again, they're kind of small on camera. I don't know if you can see them. And on the back, there's about a half a picture, plus all the team stats and the player stats. That's the hottest major league card right now. And I guess the hottest player almost overnight is Greg Maddox. Now that he's with the Braves, even though he only has cards with the Cubs, people have been coming in every day this week asking for Greg Maddox cards. He won't have a card with the Braves till next year when they can get a picture of him in a Brave uniform. But that has also spurred on Brave sales. People are coming in asking, say, for young gun subsets with Maddox, Avery, Glavin, Smoltz, and Pete Smith, and the other Brave players. The Donruss are out in 2 series right now, so it's not even known yet if Maddox is in the first series or not. Hopefully they'll save him for the second series so they can put him in when he is in the Brave uniform. Second series will probably be out in March or April. Donruss also includes insert cards of Diamond Kings, which is last year's popular feature with scarcer, higher glossy cards that are nice and collectible. There's 13 in the first series and 13 in the second. And they also have an insert card called Spirit of the Game. That's the players who embody the spirit and the fun and the soul of baseballers. About 10 players in that subset. And one other thing at this time of the year, little trinket items are selling. You know, they're good gifts, such as this Tom Glavine plaque or this Deion Sanders plaque. You know, they're good stocking stuffers at this time of the year. And people gobble this kind of stuff up. You have tomahawks with their pictures on it or tie clips or whatever. But this is just a little plaque with Glavine's picture and the wood back base and a metal nameplate and Brave plate. So at this time of the year, just little gift items are also very collectible and hot. So that's what we're seeing most of at the card shop these days. And it stays strong through the Christmas season and New Year's. And then you gear up in January with the arrival of all the other new cards of Upper Deck, Tops, and Fleer that will follow Donruss. Then the new season starts with spring training and we get going again. And that's what we have in the collecting world these days. Now back to Jeff and Ty.
All right. I'd like to thank Rick from Gwinnett Sports Cards for that report on sports card collecting. Before Ty and I get back into the show, I want to thank our sponsors, Atlanta Knights Hockey Club, Sports Life Fitness Centers, and Atlanta Voice Newspaper. Ty, college season is pretty much over. That means NFL games on Saturday. Let's talk about the NFL.
Well, you got a couple of matches coming down the wire, fighting for playoff spots. There's a couple of 8-5 teams, Washington and Philadelphia, still fighting for their lives to hang on to some of these final playoff spots in the NFC. And some big games coming up.
All right. There's four teams that have clinched berths, three of them in the NFC. We're talking about San Francisco, New Orleans, and Dallas.
Right. That Dallas team is a really strong team. I thought Washington would be the team to beat still in the East, but Dallas has just been one of the most improved teams. And that was a playoff team last year, Jeff. And they're loaded. That is a solid football team. And with the strong running game, and the running game is something that coaches have been emphasizing on this year, especially with injured quarterbacks and with defenses geared more mm-hmm. to stop the passing game. And Emmitt Smith, oh boy, he's had a field day out there.
Yeah, you have to give this credit to Jimmy Johnson. He went out and got the players he wanted to get, and boy, they're a force to be reckoned with now.
I don't think there's any doubt. He only has a handful of players left from the Tom Landry days, and that wasn't too long ago.
Mm-hmm. All right, San Francisco seems to be back on their normal perch atop the NFC West.
Yeah, and San Francisco has a big game this week at Minnesota, but then after that, they play Tampa Bay and Detroit. And so I think they'll hold on and win that division. New Orleans has a much more difficult schedule.
Yeah. Speaking of Minnesota, they need one more win to clinch a playoff berth, but I don't think they're going to get it this week, do you?
Well, no, they have a very difficult schedule coming up. They have to play San Francisco, they have Pittsburgh, and then they end the season with Green Bay. So I don't know which team they're going to get that last win against.
Maybe Green Bay? All right, we have a phone call. Caller, you're on the air.
Yes, do you think Joe Montana will play in the playoffs this year?
Thanks for your call. I don't think he's going to play. I've heard some trade rumors that he may be out of San Francisco at the end of the year, as shocking as that is.
Plain and simple, no. I mean, San Francisco is 11-2 right now, and Steve Young really has this team going, and they're playing well. San Francisco is going to be an awfully hard team to beat. And it wouldn't surprise me one bit to see them in the Super Bowl again.
I think you can make an argument for Steve Young being the best quarterback in the league, and that right there tells you that Montana's going to be on the bench. All right, let's move on. Maybe another surprise team, so to speak. Pittsburgh has a resurgence. They've clinched a berth. They're going to win the AFC Central.
At the beginning of the year, I thought Houston would win that league just out of default, but Pittsburgh has really come around and has played well this year. An easy schedule helped with that, Jeff. But like we mentioned before, strong running games have really assisted teams this year because of the defenses trying to stop the pass. And Foster's had a really good year for Pittsburgh, and they've really gone to a run-oriented offense, and it's been successful for them. They've done what they've needed to do to win football games.
All right. You mentioned Barry Foster. I think he's the league's leading rusher. I think we have a phone call. Caller, you're on the air. Hello?
Yes. This rookie name, Rodney Vaughn, do you think he would get moved up from the Richardson Braves up to the Atlanta Braves?
I didn't quite catch the name. Did you, Ty?
Rodney Vaughn, V-A-U-G-H-N.
Okay.
Rodney Vaughn. I don't recognize his name.
I don't either, but to be honest with you, Jeff, I think that the Braves roster is pretty much set with the players that they want to have on this team. Maybe a few changes in and out with some pitchers, and that's about it. I think they have the what you saw last year is basically what you're going to see this year.
I think if you're talking about hitting prospects, you got to look at Melvin Nieves, Ryan Klesko, and Chipper Jones as being the top three. I don't think anybody will make it up before those guys.
Right, and then the catcher.
Javier Lopez.
Yeah, Lopez, right.
All right, back to the NFL. Thanks for your call. Who are we talking about, Pittsburgh?
Right, we just finished up with Pittsburgh.
All right.
Jeff, I think that that's a team that I think is overrated. I just don't think they are as good as some of these other football teams are. And like I said, I think their schedule has had a lot to do with that.
All right, back to the phones. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello, go ahead.
Yes, I know of a pro football player by the name of Rodney Vaughn. He plays for the Atlanta Falcons.
Okay.
And he's having a little trouble, trying to return punts and everything. Do you think that they'll have some playing time for him in the near future if they take Deion Sanders out?
Well, I think there's going to be a lot of players that will get chances once Deion leaves. And this is an interesting situation, Jeff. Deion has been going back and forth with the Braves and the Falcons. Both of them were winners.
Mm-hmm.
Now the Falcons are losers, basically. Is Deion going to sit there and make these same arrangements that he made last year, going from one city to another, running himself crazy? I have a feeling he's not. And I'll tell you something else. The Braves protected him. And if another team would have taken Sanders in the draft, they would have been taking a big chance. And the Braves, I think, have settled something with Eugene Parker and Deion Sanders, and I don't think there's too many people who know about it yet. And certainly if there was, you don't want that information to get out while Deion's still playing with the Falcons. So to answer their question out there, yes, there's going to be several other people that will have opportunities to do some of the things that Deion did, because I don't think he's going to be around for a while next year.
Well, you may be right. I know John Schuerholz is probably making a big push to sign him, and you sort of hint that it may already be done. The Braves would like to trade Ron Gann and stick Deion Sanders in left field next year.
Yeah.
All right, let's go back to the phones. Caller, you're on the air.
Yeah, I'm just sort of sick about Brett Favre, and I was wondering if y'all felt the same way. That I felt like I really knew he was going to be great. And then, you know, they just went and gave him up, and he's definitely going to be one of the coming quarterbacks in the NFL. And I just, you know, he plays with a separated shoulder, and he makes it happen for the Packers. And just wonder what you thought about that.
I would have to agree with you there. The Falcons let one go, and I think that's Jerry Glanville's fault. I think Brett sort of got in his doghouse a little bit, maybe didn't pick up the system fast enough, and Jerry determined that he would never play in the NFL.
I agree with that. I think they gave up on Favre way too early. The first time he really made a name for himself and impressed people was when Southern Miss had to play this quote-unquote home game with Florida State in Jacksonville, and they went in there and beat him. And Favre was the quarterback. Apparently, this is the type of player that knows how to win and get the job done in some big games, as he did down there in Hattiesburg. I agree. We let one go, and okay. I don't like it either. And you're right. It's because of the Glanville system.
All right. They're giving us a wrap-up sign, but I wanted to get a quick comment on the wild rumor that Manon Rion may play for the Knights tomorrow.
Hey, why not? They have three games coming up in 3 days, and so isn't it ironic also that if she plays, it's going to be a game on TV as well?
That's true. They play at 1 o'clock tomorrow at the Omni, and they also have a game Sunday night, so I'd like to encourage you guys to get out and see them. In the meantime, we're going to wrap it up for today. This is our last live show for the next month. We're going to be rerun next Friday night at 8:30. And join us in January.